Good afternoon, shopkeepers and do-it-yourselfers out there in the YouTube land. And today we're working on a 2019 Nissan Rogue. Just did a tire rotate on it, seeing that the front brakes were pretty close to wore out, and decided now was a good time to go ahead and take care of that. You can see there's very little life left in the pad compared to the new ones. And I know many of you do know how to do this. This video is not for you. The video is for the guy that has questions. And usually I would go ahead and maybe I would replace them rotors. I don't have a brake lathe anymore. I haven't had one for pretty close to 20 years. Most of the rotors anymore are composite, and if they're warped and you turn them, in about 15 miles they'll be warped again. And the cost of rotors anymore is, you know, it's just go ahead and put new rotors on. But this does not have, this is my wife's car, and it doesn't have any checking or warpage or uneven wear or scoring or anything like that. So we're just gonna leave them on there. And but if you've got to replace the rotors and you need to take these probably maybe 17 or 19 millimeter head bolts right there, two of them, and take this caliper mount bracket off, and then there's no retainer clip or screw that goes, taper head screw that goes in there. So you just take and pull that off and maybe smack it with a 2.5 pound sledge out here at the end and up here at the front, and it'll wobble it right off. But anyway, there's things that you want to check. Number one, I've already pushed the piston in on the caliper, and we've got a little air bubble in the piston seal. And I don't like to leave that in there because your caliper or your bracket, daggone it, your brake pad could pinch that. So I'm going to take and do the right thing. I'm going to take a sharp pick, and I'm just going to poke a little bitty air hole in that rubber boot, and that'll let that fold in. Let me get a screwdriver instead of that pick. We don't need two holes in there. Yeah, that you can't get that in there if you don't put a little bitty breather hole in there. That's all that is a debris seal. That's not a fluid seal. That's a debris seal. Keeps road crap and all that from getting into the caliper. Then you want to check and make sure that your caliper mount pins are free, so they both move. That one's a little bit dry, but regardless, I roll that seal off of the pin, and I take them out, and I lubricate with it's CRC is what I use, but you've got a pin with an isolator. I don't know, it's kind of a hard rubber. I'm not sure what vibration dampener or whatever. It helps to break that chatter that might come through a brake system, but it goes away from the primary direction of travel. The primary direction of travel, this is the driver's side, is counterclockwise. So that would be towards the direction of travel, and this is away from the direction of travel. So it always goes in there. I use this stuff and coat. I don't put a whole lot on those, you know, just a coating about like that, but on the whole pin. And if those don't move, then your caliper is not going to relax after you let off the brake pedal, and you'll wear You'll wear the inner pad, well, depending on how it sticks. If the caliper doesn't move, the outer pad will not wear, and the inner pad will. And so you get a rotor that's getting excessively hot on one side, and it'll cause it to warp and all kinds of stuff. And then you want to take and check your pad hardware, your retaining hardware, and I went ahead and I'm going to replace it. There's nothing wrong with it, but those springs kind of get fatigued and they could break. So, and they come with it, so you can go ahead, or most brake kits come with it, and just take a screwdriver and come in here and pry in and pop it loose from the caliper bracket, that is, and then we'll go up here to the desk. I take an air hose and blow all the crap out of there. If you got a lot of rust checking in there, you'll need to get that. You'll probably need to take your bracket off and clean that rust checking, so your pad will go in there without a lot of resistance, and your pad will slide like it's supposed to. It's not supposed to rattle, but it's supposed to be able to move. Anyway, so we got our parts laid out. You got four of your brake pad shims. They're all four the same. There's no difference in them. But some of them, you know, some vehicles, there's a top and a bottom. So basically, you got a right and a left, because they'll go on there opposite of one another. And but so you always want to check and make sure that those pieces are all the same. And then your pad springs, you got rights and lefts. See, that one makes a G. The spring points upward. That spring points upward, but it makes more like a P. So you got to take notice of that. And then your wear indicators, your noise makers, when your pad is getting wore out, this piece right there will rub on the rotor. As the pad gets closer and closer to the rotor, it'll start scratching on it and making a noise. There's four of them that are identical, and these two that are kind of like, they're subdued, they're not, I don't know if they're coated, I don't know what the difference is, but you only have four of those, but I typically only use two. I use one on the inboard pad on both sides, and that's all I ever use. But anyway, here's one of the setups, and you can see that point sticking up right there. That point sticking up, your brake pad has got it backwards. That little inset right there in the bottom of the channel. Let's see, get me a pointer. That little inset right there, that's where your spring is gonna set right in there. Okay? But it actually goes like that. And that pushes the pad away from the rotor after you release the brake pad. So it goes in there like that. No, I had it wrong. Goes in there like that. But as it's actually setting in the, and the clip like that, get it up there. Well, that's backwards. There we go. See, the pin goes to the brake surface side. That's the outside. That's not the brake surface side. That's the outside. It goes to the inside. You can see the little pin in there in that little recess. And let's look at. So we're going to take one that's like that one there, and it goes in underneath that ear. Well, we need to put it this way first. Get the hook. Oh, you can't see what I'm doing. Put the hook in there. And then, well, how in the world do you do it? Probably have to have both hands. Let's see if I can fix the camera up. Okay. So we got the pin in there. Then we'll bring it around and come between the loop and underneath that tab and pull it up under there. There we go. Okay, and then the other one is the opposite. You use a P on one end and a G on the other end. I know that sounds kind of silly, but I don't know how else to explain it. The difference in the shape. So we'll and it goes right in there. There you go. Well, that's one setup, and we'll go ahead and make the other one. And let's see. I guess it's getting time for the school children to be going to prom, and okay, this, let's see, that's got the Statler brothers jamming away on Pandora. We'll stop that so you can hear me clearer. There is a slot. It's kind of like a T. And the hook would go all the way to the end board. This would be the end board. It goes all the way over. And then the ring goes in behind that piece. And then you can see this little tab sticking up. Your ring is going to go underneath that. So with it installed, hang on a minute. With the ring installed, or the spring installed, the point goes all the way to the right in that little T slot underneath that little hook, and then it comes in underneath that little hook right there. So 1, 2, 3, and got that one in there all the way. Then we'll grab a G and go on this side. Grab a G. I'd like to have a G. A stack right now. Need a good stack. I ain't getting paid on this job because it's my wife. And come in behind that little hook. Make sure that's all the way in there in the T in the back. And that set is installed or assembled. And we need to get back over here and pull the, I'm kind of tethered. I got my phone plugged in. Pull these pins out and lubricate them properly. And then when you push them back in, that little lip, your rubber boot's going to slip up over that lip, and it goes together pretty quick, easy. You don't have to mess with it. And it's not hard to pull the boot off, but it's easier to pull it off of the pin than it is to get it back on the caliper mount. But let me get that lubricated. Hey, I use this, let's put it in there. I kind of twist it as it's going in so it'll evenly apply that grease. And as you twist it and push in, that little rubber boot slips right over that lip. But I use this brake caliper grease. They don't send me any money, but if they sent me a check, I would cash it. And I use this instead of silicone grease. I've done thousands of brake jobs, and I have found that this stuff holds up better than the silicone grease. It seems to dry up a lot faster than this stuff will. Now, it'll dry up. Anything will dry up in time, depending on how hot people get their brakes. But that seems to have better life than that silicone brake grease. So that's why I use that. And that's the only reason. It's not because they pay me, because they don't. We'll grease this one. I got that in grease. Put it in there. Like I said, I give them a twist as I'm putting them in. That distributes that grease in there good. And we'll grab them shims. Get them installed on the mount bracket. Like I said, if you got a lot of rust checking in there, you need to get it cleaned out, because that won't want to go in there all the way. And then your pad's not going to go into its spot, and they'll bind. And as a result, they'll... And see, I don't use the wear indicator. It would clip on right there or right there. But I don't use it on the outboard pad. Never have. Whoop, missed the bottom spring. I missed a top spring. Hang on, I need both hands. Okay, I got both springs in there. Okay, this is the inboard pad for the driver's side, so it would go on there like that. Okay? And this would be the leading edge, so we're going to put... We'll just go ahead and put that black one on there. We'll clip that on to the pad. I might need both hands. It's crazy how you can do something with two hands where you can't do it with one. Okay, so your rotor, primary direction of your rotor is spinning that way, so it will drag on that wear indicator. See, it sticks out below the surface of the backing plate, which is the steel. This is the friction material, and this is the steel. So the rotor would rub on that piece of metal, that clip, before it would contact your steel backing plate. It makes a horrible screeching sound. You can go to the parking lot at the gas station or the grocery store, and you can hear brakes squeaking as soon as they touch their brake pedal. The noise will go away, and that's what it is. It's that wear indicator. But it just clips right on there. We'll go over and get it installed. Okay, we got that on. And the pin is behind, or the spring is behind the pad. And it's all up in there good. And we'll go around and get the caliper mounted back up. Okay, let's see. I think I got you pointed up there where you can see what I'm doing. I already got the piston pushed in, and we'll push those slide pins in all the way. And there's a little flat spot on that pin. You turn it so it'll let the caliper drop in all the way. And these two bolts that hold that in are 14 millimeter head. And they thread into that slide pin. And you can probably see that one's got a flat spot right there, and it lets that ear drop down against that flat spot. Where's that other bolt at? There it is. Stuck to my flashlight magnet. And that little ear keeps that slide from turning. And torque on that is just good and tight. And we'll go ahead and do the right thing and bleed that. It's an 8 millimeter or a 5/16. And just be gentle. Usually they come loose. Sometimes you got to use a little bit of heat to warm up the caliper, but be careful, you'll blow your brake hose out. You can see it's dripping. That's what you call gravity feed. The pressure of the fluid up above pushes down, and every time I service this, I open them bleeder screws and just let a little drip or two come out, so I know that we're keeping good fresh fluid in and keeping all the air out of there. And anyway, we'll put a little bit of anti-seize on the studs. And other than that, this one's pretty close to done. I don't put a whole lot of this on there, just give it a little bit of a swap. And sometimes your aluminum alloy wheels will stick, and give a little swirl around the hub. That'll resolve that from happening. You have a flat, and then you take all the lug nuts off, the daggum wheel won't come off. It's because the wheel is stuck on the center of the hub, and that little swap of the swab of anti-seize will help prevent that. But anyway, we've got the little bleeder cap back on. That just keeps dust and whatnot getting inside the bleeder screw and plugging it up. Make sure when you put your caliper back on that your hose is not twisted. I've seen some of them twisted up like a pretzel. It's hard on the hose. And when you've got the caliper off, be careful not to let it drop and swing off of the hose. It's hard on the inner liner of them hoses, and you'll cause a restriction. It'll damage the hose, and the caliper will drag. Anyway, we're gonna call this done. I'm gonna go ahead and do the other side. It's just the same as this, but. Now, hopefully, if you had any questions, I helped you resolve those issues. and how this hardware goes back together. That was the primary thing. And anyway, appreciate you watching. Share, like, and subscribe, and comment if you will. Have a good day.